have a message for you today, and I believe that the Spirit of God is going to speak to your heart. And it's so neat. We go line upon line, precept upon precept here in this church. You say, what does that mean? Maybe some of you guys are here for the first time. You never heard terminology like that. Basically, what we do is we go verse by verse through a book of the Bible. We've chosen different books throughout the years, and we just happen to be in the book of Hebrews. We chose the book of Hebrews, and we're going verse by verse. And it's so neat how the Spirit of God just lays out seasonally things for us to learn. What do I mean by that? Well, think about Jesus. Here's Jesus. He goes into the synagogue on the Sabbath, and it just happens to be, and they would do the same thing. They would go verse by verse. And so it just happened to be that at that time, he was in the book of Isaiah saying, the Spirit of the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to release the captives, to heal the brokenhearted. I mean, and he says, today this verse has been fulfilled in your hearing. And everybody's going, where did he get these gracious words? See, the Lord knew that on that day he would be at that scripture in that synagogue and would be preaching to those people. See, God had every step of Jesus ordained. In the same way, did you know that our steps are ordered of the Lord? And there are no accidents. It's not a coincidence today that here we are a couple weeks out from Easter, and we're going to be talking about the things that we're talking about. Today, the title of the message is Christ Our Passover. Isn't that amazing? Here we are, just 2 weeks before Easter, talking about Christ Our Passover. God knew that on this day, at this time, we would be in this place dealing with this set of verses that we're going to be talking about. And today, the message is going to cause you to think. So I want to make sure you know, there's different types of messages. We all love the shouting messages, don't we? Where the preacher's got veins popping out of his neck, he's sweating, he's spitting. If you get too close, you might get some on you. You know what I'm talking about? We all love those times. We want to wave the hanky and do all that kind of stuff. There's also messages where it's a teaching message and where you get something on the inside of you that builds you strong. In this church, we endeavor to preach, right? We teach and we preach, okay? So you're going to get some of that today. But I want you to go there with me. And this is a subject that, I don't know, even though we may understand it, maybe you've seen the movies, right? Maybe you've seen the old Charlton Heston. You guys have been around for a while. You remember Charlton Heston coming down off the mountain? Some of us, we remember, you know, the cartoon, The Prince of Egypt, that sort of a thing. So you may have an idea about what we're going to be talking about today, but I believe the Spirit of God is going to reveal some truth. And not only will you get inspiration, not only will the preacher give you a little perspiration, but I believe God is going to give you a revelation that you're going to take with you today, and it's going to change the way that we live our lives. Can you say amen today? All right, you got your Bibles, Hebrews 11 chapter, turn there with me. Talking about Christ our Passover. Hebrews the 11th chapter, we're going to be in verse number 28. Hebrews 11, chapter, verse number 28, it says, by faith, he, speaking of Moses, kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he who destroyed the firstborn should touch them. Now, let me just tell you the story, okay? And let me tell it to you because I want to make sure that everybody knows what we're talking about. It says, by faith, he kept the Passover. Moses had been born. His parents hid him for 3 months. It was during a time where the children of Israel who lived in Egypt, in the land of Goshen, they had increased, and over the years, right, there was a new Pharaoh. They didn't know Joseph, didn't know Israel, didn't know all of the families over there, and they realized that the Israelites were growing. And so because of that, they started to fear the Israelites, and they started to put them in bondage, put them into slavery. And it's in this time that Moses is born. And there had been an edict from the Pharaoh to kill all of the newborn baby boys. And so they took all the babies that were under a certain age and they would throw them into the river to die. So here Moses is hid by his parents because they didn't fear the edict of the king. And so now all of a sudden they couldn't hide him any longer. He's getting too old. They can't stop anybody from knowing. So you know the story. They put him in a basket of pitch. They covered up and they release him into the water. Then Pharaoh's daughter, she's going down to the Nile River to bathe, and she finds him, she draws him out. That's why she names him Moses, because she's drawn him out of the water. Just so happens, Moses' sister Miriam's there, and she says, I just happen to know a midwife, a lady who could nurse and raise this child until he's weaned, and so it just happens to be her mom, right? And so Moses gets to go back home, gets to go be with mama and daddy and his brother and sister. And there he's raised up, and eventually when he's weaned, he goes into Pharaoh's house, and he's raised up as an Israelite. And there came a time where he thought he was going to deliver the children of Israel a certain way and thought that he knew the plan of God on his life. He decided he was going to make a distinction, but it didn't turn out the way he wanted it to. He ended up murdering an Egyptian who was abusing an Israelite. And then the next day when he goes and talks to two guys that were fighting, they said, are you going to murder us also? And he realized, you know, the gig is up. I've been had. It's known what's happened. And so he flees. And for 40 years, he's out there in the wilderness. He becomes a shepherd. He gets married. And there he is. He has children. And he's just kind of just doing his own thing, just learning the wilderness, learning being a shepherd and that sort of thing. And I believe that God had a training for him, because now all of a sudden here he is and God has a plan, God has a purpose, and God calls him back into his destiny to be the man who God had chose to deliver the nation of Israel from their bondage and from their slavery. Everybody okay still? All right, y'all staring at me. I just want to make sure you didn't check out, okay? Because it's a long story, but we're building up to where we're going to go today. So you know the story. Here he comes back. He's on mission, right? God has spoken to him. Here he goes before Pharaoh, and now all of a sudden the plagues start happening, right? Egypt is plagued. There's the frogs. There's the gnats. There's the darkness. There's the blood in the Nile River. All this stuff that happens. And what is God doing? God is systematically showing Egypt that he is greater than all of their gods. Because Egypt had a frog god, they had a gnat god, they had all sorts of gods, that little g gods that they had, that they worshiped. They worshiped the sun, right? And so because they were worshiping the sun, here comes darkness on the land. See, God, the great I am, was showing Egypt, I am. I am greater than all of your little gods that you think that you have, you think that you knew, you think the Nile River's great, let me turn that into blood. I just killed your Nile River god. You think that you got a frog, I will plague you with frog, plague them with boils, plague them with all sorts of stuff. Right? Great hail comes out of the sky. And yet, Pharaoh's heart keeps getting harder and harder and harder and harder. God had a plan. God wanted to make sure that he showed himself to be God. And in Exodus, the 11th chapter, all of a sudden here, God comes and he speaks to Moses and he says, I will once again plague the Egyptians. Now, I don't sense that God was pleased doing this. I don't sense that God is some sort of a sadist wanting to inflict pain on people. And here he is, and he's cruelly inflicting these plagues on Egypt. No, God knew what he needed to do in order to set up what he was going to set up here on the earth. And so he says, I will once more plague the Egyptians. And he says that he's going to destroy the firstborn of Egypt. And because of that, Pharaoh will drive them out of Egypt. And God speaks to Moses, and he says, I want you to go and ask of your neighbors. I want you to tell all the children of Israel, go ask of their neighbors, go ask of the Egyptians all of their ornaments, their earrings, their diamonds, their gold, their silver, all that kind of stuff, whatever precious stones they have. And in doing so, they literally plundered Egypt. Because when they went and they asked the Egyptians for these ornaments, the Egyptians had seen all the plagues, and so here they had favor with the Egyptians, and they said, yeah, sure, I'll give it to you. And they gave them all of their gold, silver, precious stones. You can see later on what they did with it, right? And you know that the Israelites had it. And so here they plundered Egypt. They took the wealth and the riches of Egypt with them. Now God gives them instruction. He says, I want you to keep what's called the Passover. Because the destroying angel is going to go throughout the land of Egypt and destroy the firstborn of every household. But I want you to go to the door of your house. You can see here on the platform we have a door. He says, I want you to take a lamb, one lamb, for one house. And I want you to slaughter that lamb there at the base of the door, right? Right there at the threshold. So I want you to slaughter the lamb. So there would be blood on the base of the door. He says, I want you to catch some of that in a bowl. And I want you to take of that blood, and I want you to smear some of it on the doorposts and on the lintels. Then I want you to go inside that house. I want you to roast that lamb. And God gave them specific instructions. I want you to roast it in fire. Don't boil it. Don't try and cook it any other way. I want you to roast it all together. Don't break a single bone of its body. And I want you to cook it with bitter herbs. And he says, and you're going to eat it with unleavened bread. I don't want any leaven in the bread. So nothing that would cause the bread to rise. You got to eat this in haste. He says, I want you to eat it with a belt around your waist, sandals on your feet, and your staff in hand. I want you to be ready to go. And he says, and don't come out of your house all night long. Because the destroying angel is going to pass through the land, and as he passes through the land, when I come and I see the blood applied to the doorpost and the lintel of your house, I will pass over your house. And the destroying angel will not go inside. So you know the story here. Moses Remember in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse 28, we just read it, by faith kept the Passover. He heard the word of God. Now, by faith, he does what is pleasing to God. He acts and he keeps the Passover, him and all of Israel with him. So you can imagine what happened that night. Here, the whole nation at twilight, there they are at their doorpost. There they are slaughtering the lamb. They go inside the house, and the whole nation of Israel has one big barbecue, right? There they are, and they've got they're roasting lamb. It probably smelt amazing. Anybody like the smell of cooking meat? Man, I tell you, I can smell a grill from miles away. Hamburgers, right? Probably smelt amazing. You hear every family, one family for one lamb. The lamb was enough for the whole family. And if you had a little family, you could share with your neighbors, right? So here they are, and they keep the Passover. They eat it with the bitter herbs. The bitter herbs were to remind them of the suffering and the bondage in Egypt. 430 years they were in captivity. Those bitter herbs were there to remind them it was a bitter time for Israel. They eat their unleavened bread. In fact, they had a little pouch that they put the unleavened bread in so that when they were traveling later on, they would have bread in their travels. And there they are that night, and they all stayed inside. And as God swept through the land of Goshen, the destroying angel passed over the houses of Israel because they had blood applied to the door. But the Bible tells us that there was not one household in Egypt, from the least, from the poorest to the poor to the greatest, from Pharaoh himself, his own house, the firstborn of every house, now was slain. And Pharaoh came to Moses bitter, angry, and he drove him out. He said, get out of here. Just go. Go worship the Lord. Go on. Get out of here. Get away from us. Go and do what you need to do. For I know that the Lord is God. And so he goes out, and in coming weeks after Easter, we'll be describing about the Red Sea crossing and how God, in one foul swoop, just with one mighty outstretched arm and a strong hand, just wiped out the army of the greatest nation on the planet in the Red Sea crossing. It's amazing what took place. But for our purposes today, here we are talking about the Passover, and specifically Christ, our Passover. What do we need to know about this story? Okay, if we're going to take away something from the Passover, what do we need to know about the Passover? Three things. I've got it in one sentence. I'll put it up on the overheads for you. Okay, first thing we need to know is that the blood was applied. Second thing we need to know is that they were full of the lamb. And the third thing we need to know is that they were ready to go. Okay, you guys got that up there on the overheads? You guys see that? If you're taking notes, you can write that down. This is what we need to know about the Passover. Is that number one, the blood was applied to the houses. Okay, let's take a look at each of these. You're there in the book of Hebrews. Turn with me to the book of Exodus. Exodus, we're going to be in chapter 12. Exodus chapter number 12. And take a look at verse number 6 and verse number 7. Exodus chapter 12. Verse number 6 says this. It says, now you shall keep it, keep what? The Passover, until the 14th day of the same month. Okay, talking about the sheep. You'll keep the sheep. You'll examine it. You'll make sure there's no spot, there's no blemish. Keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it, shall kill the Passover lamb at twilight. Verse 7, and they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it. Drop down to verse number 13. Look at it. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. Okay, so let me show this to you. I want to illustrate this for you, okay? I want to make sure that you get a hold of this. So up here on the stage, I just happen to have my Passover lamb blood, okay? And here I've got they had to take a bunch of hyssop. So this is my hyssop today. I actually don't even know what this thing is. Okay, maybe it's a baster or something like that. Some of you guys might be able to tell me how to use this later with some barbecue sauce and some spices. All right. Now, the hyssop branch was interesting, okay? The hyssop branch was a branch that the stems were hollow. And because it was in arid places, it would store water inside of the stems. So they were supposed to take this hyssop branch, and they were supposed to dip it in the blood, and then they would spatter that blood here on the door, okay? And they made sure to put it on the doorposts and on the lintels. When they would spatter that blood there on the doorpost and on the lintels, it would break open the stem, and not only would the blood of the lamb be applied, but also water would come out and pour out there on the doorpost and on the lintel. So let me show this to you, okay? Some of you guys are wondering, am I going to mess up the carpet? Absolutely. So they would take the blood here, and they would apply some of it to the doorposts, okay? And they would apply some of it to the lintels. Now, I want you to notice something about this, okay? They had blood on every side. There was blood there on the base, there was blood on each of the doorposts, and blood on the lintels. So when they went inside of their house, they had to pass through the blood in order to get inside. Are you listening today? They were surrounded on every side, top to bottom, left to right, front and back, right, by the blood of the Lamb. So when they entered, now they had to enter through that blood, okay? So we need to know that the blood was applied. Second thing we need to know is that they were full of the Lamb, okay? They were full of the Lamb. Let's take a look at it, Exodus chapter 12, verse number 8. Exodus chapter 12, verse number 8, then they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire, with unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Now, we already talked about the bitter herbs. They were to remind them of the bitter times that they had in slavery. But also, they were supposed to eat unleavened bread. Why were they supposed to eat unleavened bread? Here's why. They were supposed to be eating it in haste. In other words, the leaven that they ate took time. You had to knead it. Any of you guys make bread, right, or you make pizza dough or whatever, and you put a little leaven in there, you start to knead it into the dough, and then what do? You leave it there for a while, you put a wet towel over it or something like that in the bowl, and it rises, okay? So there was a mixture that was taking place. And here God is telling Moses, I don't want them to be wasting time and taking time and allowing the leaven to go into the bread and cause change in there. I want it pure. I want it unleavened, and I want to make sure that you understand that this is something that they're going to eat in haste. And when they leave, they will still have that unleavened bread with them, and they will be able to eat. Okay? Blood applied, full of the Lamb, ready to go. Exodus chapter 12, verse number 11 this time. And thus you shall eat it with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. So here they were supposed to eat it ready to go, because at any time, in the middle of the night, after the firstborn had been slain, the call could go out that we are leaving. We are going out. We're not going to wait around and see whether or not the Egyptians are for real. We're going to go. And so have your sandals on, have your belt around your waist, have your staff in your hand, and anything that you're taking with you, get ready, because we are going to leave and we're going to get out of Egypt. So they had to be ready. They had to eat it in haste. They had to eat all of it. They could not leave any of it. There was no leftovers. There was no, lamb sandwiches the next day or any of that kind of stuff. If they had any leftovers, they had to burn it up completely, okay? And so they had to eat it in haste. They had to eat all of it. They had to consume it, and they had to be ready to go, because now here Pharaoh tells Moses, get out of here. Go. Go and worship the Lord. And at that moment, the call went out, and they left. Now, everything that we're talking about today is before the cross. But did you know that everything in the Old Testament speaks of something, some sort of a truth, and is a picture of Jesus in the New Testament? Okay, so in the Old Testament, the New Testament is contained, but in the New Testament, the Old Testament is explained. Are you listening? In the Old Testament, the New Testament is enfolded. In the New Testament, the Old Testament is unfolded. Hello. So everything that we see in the Old Testament, you can take it to the cross and you can see what happens to it. What do I mean by that? Any truth that you find in the Old Testament, when you take it to the cross, one of three things will happen. Either number one, it'll stay the same, right? Like the love of God. Take the love of God to the cross. You will see the love of God in the cross, right? And on the other side of the cross, the love of God is still the love of God. It's the same. Jesus Christ, same yesterday, today, and forever. So here's God, gracious, compassionate, kind, full of mercy, full of love, right? He's the everlasting God. That does not change when you go to the cross, okay? Second thing that happens when you take things from the Old Testament to the cross, they may stop at the cross. What things stop at the cross? Well, the sacrificial system stopped there, right? We don't need to sacrifice animals every day any longer. There is no longer the Day of Atonement every day. Jesus was the sacrifice once and for all. He finished the work of redemption, and now when you take those sacrificial systems, the traditions, the ordinances, the observances, the days, the new moons, the Sabbaths, all that kind of stuff, when you take that to the cross, it stops at the cross. Now, every day is holy. Every day is a Sabbath day of rest. Every day, now, we have the perfect sacrifice that is still strong enough. The blood is enough for our lives. The blood of Jesus now, as it's covered our lives, it's cleansed us from sin. There's no longer a need for another sacrifice of sin. It stops right there at the cross. But then there's things in the Bible that we see that when you take them to the cross, on the other side of the cross, when they go through the cross, it changes. So some things go through and they stay the same. Some things stop, some things change. Like what? Well, how about the atonement? You know, we use that word atonement. Atonement in the Old Testament meant covering, right? The atonement in the Old Testament was just a covering. Every year they would sacrifice the blood of an animal and they would just cover sin. They would just take a time and they would cover it once again, and they would cover it once again. Every year they had to cover it again because why? The blood wasn't strong enough. But now in the New Testament, when you take a look at the word atonement that and you put it through the cross, now all of a sudden on the other side of the cross, it changes. It's almost like passing light through a prism now. While on one side of the prism it's white light, on the other side you get a rainbow. See, here we take the atonement and we put it through the cross, and what happens on the other side is atonement no longer means covering, but now the meaning changes to mean exchange. In other words, my filthy, sinful, spotted, dirty life that now is not just going to be covered, but now I'm exchanging that. I'm turning that into Jesus. I'm handing my life over to Jesus, and now he gives me his perfect, spotless, sinless life. My rags were now given to Christ for his riches. That's why the Bible says, he who knew no sin became sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. See, when you take your filthy life to the cross, on the other side of the cross, you're no longer a sinner. You are changed, and now you are a saint. I told you we're going to preach today, right? Hallelujah. So what do we see? Now, when we look at Passover, when we take Passover to the cross, what happens to it? It changes. See, we still have elements of the Passover in our life, but now they've changed because of the cross. Now it's not just the blood applied, full of the lamb, ready to go. Now the blood of Jesus is applied. The blood of Jesus is applied. John chapter 3, turn there with me if you will. John the 3rd chapter, most famous verse in the Bible is John chapter 3, verse number 16, right? If you know it, quote it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life, right? Most famous verse of the Bible, right there. You see it all over billboards, you see it on cars, see it on bumper stickers, right? People got it on their t-shirts, they got it on their belt buckle, they got it all over the place. See some sort of a rally, right? Political rally. Somebody's holding up John 3:16, right? Making sure somebody knows about Jesus, that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, right? But John chapter 3, take a look at verse number 17, very next verse. I want to show this to you because we're talking about the blood that is applied to the doorposts of our lives. Look at this, John chapter 3, verse 17. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. That the world through him might be saved. That the world through him might be saved. See, in order to get into your house, you had to pass through the blood of Jesus. The blood of the Lamb that was applied. That the world through him might be saved. Verse number 18. He who believes in him is not condemned. Oh, thank God for that. Because we were all headed for hell in a handbasket. We were slipping down a pole with grease lightning on it, right? Headed straight into hell. And yet, when now you apply the blood, something happens. He who believes in him is not condemned. But he who does not believe is condemned already. Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. See, this is kind of a hard truth for people to accept. And some of you guys are not going to like this. But this is the truth of God's word. Every person on the planet was born into sin. It's a condition that we all have in our lives. Bible tells us in Romans, the 5th chapter, that even though we may not have sinned in the likeness of Adam, we all followed his example and we all entered into sin on our own. In other words, everybody on the planet has rebelled in some way except one. His name is Jesus. As you examine the lamps, as you take a look at the lives of the people, every single one of them, you will find a spot. You will find a blemish. It may not look like taking of the tree of the knowledge of good and of evil like Adam did and rebelling against God's commandment, but it may look like something else. All of us, doesn't matter how perfect your life is, doesn't matter how good you are or how good you think you are, you could have been raised in church, you could have been a goody-goody two-shoes, but somewhere along the lines, you messed up. You say, I never murdered anybody. No, but Jesus raised the stakes, didn't he? He said, you ever hated somebody in your heart, you've already committed murder. And you start hedging and dodging. Well, I never committed adultery, never done any of that stuff. You know, I never did any of that. Okay, but Jesus raised the stakes once again. If you lusted in your heart, you've already committed adultery. Whoa. And then the book of James comes along and says, if you broke one part of the law, you broke the whole law. That means we're all lawbreakers. That means that the justice of God must be satisfied, and therefore there is wrath being stored up for disobedience. And God is just in that wrath. See, people don't like to hear about this, but this is the truth of God's word right here. This is good, solid Bible teaching, and we need to understand and talk about sin. We need to talk about the condemnation. We need to talk about hell, because it's real. Very real. And yes, Jesus died for everybody, but not everybody will be saved. Why? Because he who does not believe is already condemned. See, the wrath of God is, the justice of God must be satisfied. But if you would examine the Lamb, oh, come on, somebody. The perfect, spotless, sinless Lamb. Jesus Christ, the righteous, who came into the world, and even though he lived in the flesh, he never entered into sin. He was tempted as we are in all points, yet without sin, the Bible tells us. And now, when we look to the cross and we apply the blood of Jesus to our life, see, let me show this to you for a second, okay? Because this is not just natural things. We're talking about the blood of Jesus. When you look to Jesus now and you apply the blood to the lintels of your life, now all of a sudden, top to bottom, now you have the blood of Jesus that has been applied to your life, and then you apply it to the doorpost here. Take a look at this. What happens is now you are no longer looking to yourself for salvation. Now you are looking to the cross of Jesus Christ. Powerful. Powerful when you understand what that's all about. See, you cannot get to salvation. There is no other way of salvation except by faith in the blood of Jesus. No other name given on heaven or on earth by which we must be saved than the name of Jesus. Take a look at the last verse in John chapter 3, verse number 36. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. And he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. Remember, in the nation of Egypt, the destroying angel was going to go through every house. Didn't matter. Israelite, Egyptian. If somebody from the nation of Israel had heard Moses' command and said, hey, you know what? I don't believe in that. I don't think Moses really has this thing down. I don't think he knows what he's talking about. Maybe he's gone crazy. Maybe God didn't really speak to him. I don't think I need to apply the blood. And they just kind of were chilling in their house, having a good time that night. They all went to bed. You know what would happen? They would have woken up and the destroying angel would have came in and would have destroyed the firstborn. Why? Because it was on everybody. But God says, if I see the blood, I will pass over the house. See, it's no different in our lives. Everybody was condemned already. We all were headed for hell. And yet, when God sees the blood applied to our lives, he knows that the wrath of God has been poured out on the cross for Jesus. And now we are covered, and also we have exchanged, and now we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and the wrath of God passes over our lives. Are you listening? Are you listening? Martin Luther, the great reformer, said, either sin is with you lying on your shoulders or it's lying on Christ, the Lamb of God. Now, if it's lying on your back, you are lost. But if it's resting on Christ, you are free and you will be saved. Now choose what you want. So the blood of Jesus now is applied to our lives. But second thing is this, it's not just full of the Lamb. It's not a natural thing anymore. Now we are full of his word. See, it's not enough just to stop at the cross. We have to grow in the wisdom and in the knowledge of God. And we have to be feeding on the Lamb of God, feeding on Jesus. Remember, Jesus is the Word of God. He is the Lamb that came into the world, and now we feed on Him. In fact, now, Jesus came and He said, I am the bread of life, right? Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has life in him. Wow, that's pretty amazing. And it's not just a leavened bread, it's an unleavened bread. And Jesus defined that for us, didn't He? You'll find the leaven all throughout the Word. But listen to this. Most of the time you'll find it's not a good thing. You remember the parable of the woman who took three measures, right? And she hid leaven on the inside of it, and she kneaded it in until it leavened everything. You say, well, that doesn't really help. I don't really understand that. Okay, let's unpack it from the Word. Jesus is talking to the disciples. He had just fed the 5,000, fed the 4,000. They're in the boat, and the disciples start talking, and Jesus pipes up, and He says, hey, guys, beware the leaven of the Pharisees. And they say, we didn't bring any bread. Jesus is talking about bread. We forgot to. Did you bring the bread? Philip, Nathaniel, Andrew. God, what's wrong with you guys? Man, I thought you were getting the bread. And they start talking about bread. And Jesus says, whoa, time out, you guys. Really? Really? You're talking about you didn't bring any bread? Don't you remember I fed the 5,000? Don't you remember I fed the 4,000? That's just the men, not even the women and children. Tens of thousands of people are fed with just a little loaf. Doesn't matter if you have any bread in the natural. I'm not talking about natural things, guys. Talking about beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. What was the leaven of the Pharisees? It was the doctrine, the teaching that they brought. See, a little leaven gets in there and it starts to work its way through and it starts to expand and it starts to put impurities in there. And so He says, I want you to watch out that you don't listen to what they're saying, because if you look at the fruit of their lives, they're not living it out. So He says, I want you to beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. You're there in John. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter number 5. 1 Corinthians chapter number 5, verse number 6 through verse number 8 says this. Here the church of Corinth has had some stuff going on. There's some sexual immorality going on, and they're proud of it. They're parading it around. And here the Apostle Paul corrects them, rebukes them, and gives them instructions about what they're supposed to do. And he says in verse number 6, he says, your glorying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? In other words, you allow a little bit of sexual immorality in there, and you say that's okay, eventually everybody in church is going to be entering into the same thing. See, there are destructive doctrines, leaven of this world that is coming into the church in these last days. And Jesus is warning us, be careful. Be careful what you do with sin. Be careful what you do. See, I will give you that you may have been born that way, right? We're all born into sin, but you were not born again that way. You got a new nature now. You got a new DNA. You got a new family. Your spirit man has been born again, and now your mind needs to be renewed. So beware of the leaven of this world. There are philosophies, there are doctrines, there are teachings, there are systems of understanding out there that are contrary to the Word of God. And if you allow them in, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. In other words, if I'm going to allow it here, eventually it's going to work its way over here, and then it's going to get its way over here, and eventually my whole life is going to be a mess. And there are people who have shipwrecked themselves in the faith because they said, oh, it's fine, it's okay. It's not going to hurt anything. Well, you know, we love each other. Don't have to be married first. Come on, somebody, can we talk? You know what? Yeah, I used to struggle with that in my old life, but just one little drink won't hurt. See, you got to be careful of the leaven of the Pharisees. Be careful of the leaven of this world. Look at what it says in the next verse. Verse number 7, therefore purge out the old leaven. Get rid of the old ways. Get rid of the old thinking, that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. So He's talking about, remember, we're taking everything to the cross. Now it's changing. Now you are unleavened. Look at this. For indeed, Christ our Passover was sacrificed for us. So Christ is our Passover. And because Christ was sacrificed for us, we should keep the Passover and we should eat unleavened bread. We should not allow that leaven to get in there and leaven through the whole lump. Verse number 8, therefore, let us keep the feast, not with the old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness. Wickedness is operating in ways that are contrary to the ways of the Lord. He says, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I know that you're sincere. I know that there is a purity in your heart that you want to serve God. That's why you came to church today. You want to learn more about God. You want to operate in greater measure of obedience in the things of God. You want to be pure in your understanding. You want to be pure in your heart. You love the Lord and you want to serve him wholehearted. I know that about you because you're in church today. But you've got to sweep out, drive out. See, the children of Israel, the beginning of their year, they had to sweep all the leaven out. And for 7 days, the first week, they ate nothing but unleavened bread. And if anybody ate leavened bread, they were cut off from Israel. That's how serious they were about it. And in our lives, we need to get rid of those things. If you got to go home, you got to get rid of some CDs, some magazines, some stuff you've been hiding under the bed. If you got to get rid of the internet access or give your wife or your husband the password so that you are accountable. Maybe you got to turn in your smartphone for a dumb phone because it's starting to cause you to stumble. Maybe you got to cut off some relationships because every time honey be calling, you know, something bad going to happen. Can we talk today? See, we got to talk about this stuff in church because if we don't talk about it in church, the leaven's going to keep getting through. But we need to sweep it out of our life. No, get that nasty stuff out of my life. I'm not putting up with that any longer. I'm going to take a stand. We're going to sweep it out. And now I am unleavened. Now that leaven's not going to stay. It's not going to affect me. I'm going to be pure and sincere and operate in truth. What's truth? What's truth? Truth is what God says. Jesus said, your word is truth. Which brings us to the last thing. Not only has the blood of Jesus been applied, not only are we full of the word, but we are readily obedient. Ready to go. That at any moment, when God calls, when God speaks now, we are ready to obey the word of God. 1 Peter chapter number 1, verse number 17 through verse number 19. 1 Peter, right after Hebrews, you'll find 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse number 17. Look at what it says. And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear. Fear means reverence. Fear means awe. Fear means that you tremble at the word of God. In other words, you don't just fill up with the word of God and expand this, but you allow it to get down in here and expand this. Expand your heart. So he says, if you call upon the Father who judges without partiality, not just what you know, but what you do, he says, conduct the time of your stay here in fear. Look at verse 18, knowing. Everybody say knowing. Knowing. We ought to know this stuff. When the Bible says knowing, it means you should be knowing this. What does knowing mean? It means you understand it up here and you operate in it here. It gets on the inside of you and it changes the way that you live. It's not just a seed planted in the soil of the ground of your heart, but now it's a fruit that is coming out of your life. Knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers. Verse 19, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot. As you instantly obey the word of God, as you submit yourself to the word of God and come underneath the authority of the word of God, it will make you more and more like Jesus each and every day. You're going to look more like that lamb. Perfect, sinless, spotless. We mess up? Yes, of course. But then we take it back to the cross and we say, Lord, forgive me. I just put this under the blood of Jesus. I ask that you cleanse me. And you get the word of God, you renew your mind, you get that purity, you get that sincerity, you get that word down on the inside, and then you operate in it, you work it out, you live it out in your life, ready to go. When you hear the sound of God saying, child, will you go? You say, here I am, send me, I'm ready to go, God. I got my belt of truth on my waist, a theater shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. You want me to go tell someone about Jesus, Lord? I'm ready, I got my staff in hand. I'm going to take the authority of the word of God, sword of the spirit, shield of faith. My helmet is on, God. My armor, my breastplate of righteousness. It's covering my heart, Lord. I'm keeping myself pure, God, and I am ready to go, God. What is it that you want? Your servant is listening, Lord. Speak to me today, Lord, in Jesus' name. And now, all of a sudden, you go out and you do great and mighty things for God. Christ, our Passover. What do we need to know? Blood applied, full of the Lamb, ready to go. New Testament, what's it look like for us? Blood of Jesus applied to our lives. Looking to that cross, full of the word of God, and readily obedient. Did you guys get something from the word today?